Yeah, thank you so much, my brother and friend. And thank you all for ministering. Thank you for inviting me once again. And I'm very much humbled. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. And these days I add Sarongo, because I'm a Sarongo. And when I'm in Buganda, that's a very important title. In Kabale, it is normal. So thank you, friends, for tuning in. And our topic is confession in prayer. And as I was preparing, I really found out that the reason why we don't confess is simply because of pride. If you are proud, confession can't be part of you. If you are not a humble person, you feel you are justified that you are right. And so confession is like a weakness. And let me tell you, friend, as long as you are in sin and you have a sin and you do not confess it, it doesn't matter what you have or what you do. It is a burden. You are in prison. So this afternoon, we want to shake the foundation of unforgiveness, of lack of confession, so that those prison chains may totally leave you, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for each of these, my brethren, tuning in. I pray that as we share about confession, it will be real in our hearts, and our lips shall declare what is in our hearts, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So the topic is confession in prayer. And as I said, if you don't confess, it means you are proud. And pride kills. And there are so many of us who really justify ourselves that, you know, my father is wrong, so it is him to confess to me. My pastor or my wife or my husband or my child is wrong, so they are the ones to say sorry. If they don't, then I won't. Let me tell you, friend, that's from the devil. And pride, again, kills, because the Bible says in Isaiah that God can't share his glory. So is there something you haven't confessed? This afternoon, we are to confess. And Psalm 51, like the scene in Nani Kanani, where somebody very big, somebody who was close to God with a humble background, had to say, Lord. And if you read properly, David, he was chosen among the boys. They were seven, and the father knew this is not useful. Even the prophet Samuel, who is a reverend canon of then, couldn't pick David. In fact, he picked Eliab, his elder brother. And from that humble background, God picks him. After picking him, this is what happens. He becomes a king after running away for about 13 years. When he becomes a king, time for war, he remains at home. Time for overnight, somebody's on TV. Time to go for prayer, somebody says, let me read this WhatsApp message. Time for war, David remained at home. And as he was, you know, walking around on the second floor, or first floor, I'm not sure, but he was upstairs, he saw a woman bathing. She's called Bathsheba. I'm trying to give a background of this confession. And when he saw Bathsheba, I normally wonder why Bathsheba was bathing during the day. But that's a story for another time, because that's also her wickedness. But she bathes, And the king likes her and impregnates her and calls one of his generals. Actually, Uriah the Hittite was a general. He calls him back home, gives him a drink, go and sleep with the wife. The reason was the lady had sent a message, I am plague. Plague, I'm using the modern language. And David was like, we can't abort. Let's call your husband to be the impregnator so that we hide the sin. You know, a long story short, he kills Uriah, his general. But in his killing, he kills others. Sin manifests by hurting you, hurting another one, and also hurting others. After killing, he lived with that sin, calls Bathsheba in, you are now my wife, produces a child. The child even dies. And then the story begins by Nathan coming to him and saying, by the way, you sinned. I don't want to go to the analogy he used because of time. And David now is confronted with the issue of confession. And so what is confession? Confession is a formal statement. Listen, it is formal. It is not, you know, informal, I can confess from my heart. No, it is a formal statement admitting guilt of a crime, a sin, a wrong that somebody has committed by omission or commission. There are certain things we do, even in advance, in the way, you know, we sin without even knowing. And that's why Jesus also says, we must confess our sins before we go to the altar so that when we forgive others, then our Father in heaven can also forgive us. I want to say confession and asking for forgiveness is not an option in prayer. Let me repeat that. Confession and asking for forgiveness is not an option in prayer. It is also not an option for a Christian. It is not. God's word hasn't given any, you know, side that you may not confess. No. In fact, 1 John chapter 1, verse 7 to 9, the Bible says, if we say we have no sin, we have sinned twice. We have made God a liar, and we ourselves are liars. So those are two sins. In verse 9, he says, but if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just, forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So cleansing happens, righteousness happens after confession. So this afternoon, what are you carrying? Some of us are even carrying coffins. You know, somebody died before you asked for forgiveness. So how many coffins do you carry along? And how are you bent? Do you know that that's really terrible? I can assure you, friend, carrying a coffin during the day, no. We need to break forth and ask God to forgive us. And of course, I will go to the issue of who confesses. When do we confess? Where do we confess from? How do we confess? And then I will end with why confess. So I have finished what confession is. That it is not an option. And let me tell you this, even before I continue. I had gotten saved in 1990, but I hadn't forgiven my father. And it took me 16 years, even when I'm married with children, to go to daddy and say, I'm sorry. You know, the reason was I felt I was justified to hate him. And many of us really justify that. And this afternoon, may the Lord meet you at that point of need so that you may be able to know him. Listen to what David says in Psalm 51. And listen to this. Verse 1. Have mercy on me, O God. The issue is me, my I. In other words, confession is yours. It is not supposed to be transferable, and I will come to it. So who confesses? Have mercy on me, David, or God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, brought out my, David's transgressions. Wash away all my, David's iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. Hallelujah. Verse 3, for I, Jasper, David, John, whoever you are, for I know my transgressions and my sin is always before you. Now he uses three words. One is what we call transgression, meaning you have crossed the boundary. You are going to Kenya, but you haven't cleared with the border and you're already in Kenya. Maybe you even have no passport. That's transgression. You have gone beyond your borders. He uses also the word, wash away all my iniquity, twisted feelings and perversion, pornography, lust, sexual immorality, things you do and you can't even control yourself, alcohol, you know, adultery, whatever you, it is iniquity. You are doing it, but it becomes like part of your life and it is totally twisted and out of God's word. Then, and cleanse me from sin. Sin is simply missing the mark, erring. So he uses those three words that in the case of Bathsheba, by killing Uriah the Hittite, there is transgression, there is iniquity, there is sin. So friend, if you are confessing, please confess what you did. Don't confess some other person is what? Failures. I remember in primary 5, a man called Katrianje came and he was an evangelist, a revival evangelist, and he preached. My brother was in P6, and we all cried. And then they said, come in front to repent your sins and confess. I remember, I thought now, since my brother has gone, I think I don't need to go and confess my sin. And I was greatly encouraged when he said this. I repent that me and Jasper, we normally steal meat from my mother when it is cooking and we share it. I felt I had confessed. And later, when I read the Bible, clearly it wasn't my confession, it was his confession. And many of us, therefore, this afternoon, please confess your guilty. Not the one of your husband or the children, not the one of your workmate, but deal with your sin, deal with your iniquity, deal with your transgression. So who confesses? It is you, the sinner, the person that is at the center of the challenging situation. And I thank God that David, in this classic confession, is not even beating about the bush, about Bathsheba bathing during the day, about Bathsheba having a nice shape of the body. He's simply saying, it is my transgression, it is my sin, it is my iniquity. Father, I pray that this afternoon we shall accept our sins, our transgressions, and our iniquities, so that we confess them the way David did, in Jesus' name. Amen. So who is you? And please, don't Jonah, we call it journaling in the Bible. you know, beating about the bush. You don't want to go to Nineveh. Even when you reach Nineveh, you begin blaming God. In Jonah chapter 4, it is interesting that the king, together with the whole nation, actually repented and God forgave them. Confession leads to repentance and therefore forgiveness. And let me tell you, there is no sin God will forgive unless if it is repented. Number two. So who confesses? It is you. Number two, when do we confess? We confess when we need to be washed. Now, in the Bible, in verse 5, listen to what the Bible says. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time of my mother conception. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in the secret place. Listen, when clean, create in me a pure heart, O Lord. When do you want a pure heart? Renew a steadfast spirit within me. When do you want renewal? Verse 11, do not cast me away from the presence. In other words, if you want the presence of God, even begin now, listen to what he adds. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. Verse 11, when I want his presence, his spirit, I must continuously ask him to forgive me. I must continuously repent of all my sins. Verse 12, restore to me the joy of your salvation. Let me tell you, I want the joy of my salvation. And I was telling somebody the other day that some of the things I do is because I want the presence of God, but I also want to remain joyful in salvation. So there are certain things I want to do because there is a time when I lost that joy. I fell into sin and I had, you know, walked with the Lord for 4 years. And let me tell you, for 1 year, complete year, I had lost the joy of salvation. Going to church meant nothing. Holy communion, and began dodging. Fellowship, I would say, don't go. Until when I went to the Lord and like David, asked him to create in me a pure heart. And so the time is now. The time to confess is now. Whenever you want to go to the Lord in prayer, it is time to confess. Now I will go to the types of confessions, but I want to encourage you that every time is a time for confession. Every time is a time of repentance, especially if you want God to use you, if you want his presence. And you see 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7 is an interesting verse. And I normally, by the way, go back to my wife in case there is anything so that we settle before I go to the pulpit and preach. Peter says that your prayers are hindered because of your unfaithfulness. I'm paraphrasing to your wife. In other words, if you treat your wife badly, forget about prayer. So I could confess, even when I know and the feeling that I'm right, I will ask her to forgive me simply because I do not want my prayers to be hindered. Let me ask you again, friend, do you know that every time is a time for confession? And I thank God for the revival movement. Let me tell you, my friend, they used it to confess. They used to say sorry. They used to walk in what we call a revival sana. And I pray that many of us will have such an attitude towards Christianity. Because what is missing today, what is missing, I can assure you, it is mainly this issue of the fact that we are no longer confessing sin. And so sin will confess us. In Samuel it says that if you don't confess your sin, that sin will actually confess you. Will you this afternoon be able to confess your sin is known and unknown? So I have dealt with the when. Let me go to the where. Where do we go to confess from? This is interesting because there are some traditions where they say you go to a priest, where they say you go to somebody. Let me tell you, the only person you need to go to is God in prayer. I'm using bottom line so that you know I qualify that statement. It is God you confess to. David says, only against you, O Lord. Only against who? Against God. This man had sinned against Joab, the commander, against the family of Uriah, against even Bathsheba. But listen, he said, I have sinned against you, O Lord. Why? Because that's the point where we need to begin first. You begin going to God for confession first before he sends you to those whom you have offended. So, even if you are somewhere in your bed, in your vehicle, and you want to confess, confess to God from anywhere. So there is no limitation of you confessing to God. And before I went to my father, I actually went to God and asked for forgiveness that the years where I had carried my father, especially from 1983 to 2006, Lord, forgive me, and sorted myself therefore first with God. So you go to the place of grace. You go to the place where God says you go, and then after you go to the one whom you have offended. And Jesus says, listen to this, before you go to the altar, please go and sort out with your brother. And there are so many of us, we are on the altar and you haven't sorted out. There are so many of us, we are, you know, ministers and we are carrying. This afternoon, there is a place where you should go, and that's to God. Secondly, after God, you need to sort out with the person whom you have offended. I read recently the story of Joseph again, and I cried again. I normally cry. Where Joseph is in a position to harm, but he doesn't. But his brothers in Genesis chapter 44 also reached the point of where they needed to confess. One of them called Judah said, and I quote, listen to what Judah said, I cannot go back to my father when I do not have his son called Benjamin, because we had a brother whom he even never mentioned that they sold out, and he's no more. How will I face my father without his son? A place where Joseph broke. He couldn't hold it. That people who were willing to shed blood, to save their brother, are now protecting a brother. That's confession, my friend. And he was willing to become a slave together with his children for the sake of Benjamin. And he was telling the one he had offended. And therefore, he melted. I read recently also, I finished Genesis, I'm in Exodus. I normally finish the Bible in 1 year. In Genesis again, this man called Jacob, a thief, a cheat, meets his brother Esau for 20 years. Listen to what the Bible says. They hadn't met for 20 years. But the meeting was, if I meet you, I will kill you. That was from Esau. When they met, Genesis chapter 33, and you can visit it later, read that whole story. They embraced. They began crying. They began asking, is this your wife? Are these your children? Are these your cattle? property never mattered. And listen to what Jacob said. And he had said, by the way, my name is Jacob. He had told God now the real name, not Esau, not Laban, but Jacob. But listen, he says, my brother, your face is like the face of God. And by the way, he had seen God at a place called Peniel, meaning seeing God, the face of God. He said, Esau, because of your forgiveness, because of your confession, because of now you embracing me as a brother, your face is like the face of God. And I'll come to it as I end. Friend, our relationships, when they are repaired through confession, the glory of God is manifested. So how do we confess our sins? I want to tell you again quickly. Number one, it is open confession. Open confession. Where you go to God and say, ah, me things are bad. Where you go to your wife. Let me remind us. For us, we normally have meetings with children. And one time, we were meeting with the children and we were evaluating the whole year and they were still youngish and they said, by the way, evaluate mommy, evaluate daddy, evaluate each one. And they told me that daddy says you are a dictator. You say, you, we have names. I almost stood up and said, I'm daddy, but I'm a saved daddy. I remember I said, my children, I'm so sorry. How can I be a dictator over my children? How can I close the door for my children never to come towards me? Let me tell you, friend, you need to do that. I embraced them. I said, I am so sorry. And if in the future I'm a dictator, don't wait for the whole year or for the whole term to end. Raise it with me. That's how you do confession. 51:3, for I know my transgression and my sin is always before me. Those days, those months, that year and a half, it is about 2 years, David was not sleeping. The sin was before him. And he says this, how against you and only you have I sinned and done what is even your sight, so you are right in your verdict and justified to judge me. That's how you do it. If your wife has offended you, please do that. Sometimes and most of the time, they are justified. And so it is about me because it is between me and God. And so for any disagreement with my wife, with my workmates, I normally check, where is my role? Where am I wrong? So that I repair me before I try to repair others. Only have I sinned against you, and therefore your judgment is right. The judgment was, and I quote, you are going to die. David was going to die. Without confession, you actually die. So he says, against you have I sinned, and Lord, you are right. And when he confessed, actually Nathan said, God has forgiven you. Then he also says, sure, I was sinful at birth. In other words, he was accepting his sin, and he was openly confessing. He even wrote this psalm so that it may help you to confess to others. He used his mouth, he used his pen, and he also used his heart. Romans 10:10, if we confess with our mouth, it is the mouth. So even this afternoon, as we end, we are going to give you some few time to you to write whom you confess, whom you tell that you have transgressed against God through those people. Finally, so I hope I have handled the how. Finally, why conference. And you see, it is finally because the why are the results of convention. Surely I was sinful at birth. David was not justifying that, I know I was sinful, so let me remain a sinner. No, he was simply saying, I have been sinful and I'm sinful from birth. And the benefit, therefore, of his confession is that as follows. Number one, the depth of our need is forgiveness. None on earth can say, I have never sinned. And the Bible doesn't even give us that option. And so, through confession, we obtain our basic need of forgiveness. Jesus said in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, and actually even in Matthew chapter 6, that if you forgive your brother, God will also forgive you. And so it is a need. It is a basic need, like food, water, and clothing. We need to confess our sin. Secondly, it is the truth that we need to confess and repent our sin from our inward parts. David says, from my innermost being, I am confessing. So if you don't confess again, you remain carrying. And as I said, many of us are carrying. I carried my father again for many years until 2006, when I went to him and said, Daddy, I am sorry. And let me tell you, it wasn't easy because I was justifying the carrying of him. He forgave me and we became friends. Did I change him? Maybe. But let me tell you, every Sunday I preach and every Sunday he calls. And when I don't preach on radio, he normally calls. The other day, you know, I had, because of hatred, I couldn't send him money. I couldn't send him anything. The other day, I bought a suit in December and I took it to Kabale to Dubai, and it was very cold. And I handed over a suit. I said, Daddy, this navy blue suit was made for you. He said, my son, thank you. Listen to what he said. It wasn't a joke for him, but for me, it was like a joke. That, do you know, my son, I'm praying that you become something in Kigezi. Now, I asked him, Daddy, what is it? He said that, I'm praying you become a bishop. Ooh. I said, Daddy, all you are praying for is that to become a father of a bishop. But as for me, that's not my prayer yet. But you see, for my daddy to tell me that he's praying for me, my friend, that's victory. And that's why he confesses. Even when I offend him today, I ring and say, Daddy, I am sorry. Not that he has two wives and he neglected us, but my thing is to tap into that repentance, so that I repair with my Father in heaven and my horizontal relationships will be okay. Another thing is that there are certain hidden things, hidden parts we need to confess. And I pray this afternoon also, that you also tell God that this hidden sin, which I haven't told anybody, may be able to be exposed in the name of Jesus to you, because you know, David said that there is nothing hidden from you. Nobody knows, yes, but Lord, you know. God knows your pornographies, the things you send on WhatsApp, which are useless. God knows the person you hate. So it is better to confess to God whatever, and the result is what is indeed salvation. Another one is actually salvation, that if you confess and believe in your heart, you will be saved. Romans 10:10. Quickly, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. We read it earlier. The means of restoration that when we confess, he is faithful and just, forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I want to be clean. Me, I want to be clean. I want to be righteous so that wherever I pass, even in a jam, somebody will say, this is a righteous man. When I'm preaching, for somebody to say, Jasper touched me through his righteousness. And I yearn for that. And it is a result of confession. Without confession and asking for forgiveness, forget about righteousness and cleansing and purity. Then David restored joy. Verse 12 and 13, restore the joy of my salvation. Restore the joy of my salvation. 14 to 17, restored praise. Then will I go before, oh, I praise the Lord, that David had capacity to praise him. 14 to 17. Deliver me from the guilt of blood, said, O God, you who are God, my Savior, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. Open my lips, O Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. Let me tell you, friend, if you haven't asked for forgiveness and confession, please don't even praise the Lord. You just say, let me continue. Why? Because your lips must reflect the righteousness that comes from God. You do not delight in sacrifice, why would you bring it? You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, restored spirit, a contrite heart, God will never despise. Finally, healing, James chapter 5 and verse 16. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. A prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. I'm ending with that because it is like a bonus that, let me tell you, when we confess our sins and cry out to God, the result is healing. And so some of us are sick. Why? Because we are caring. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for each of these, my brother, that this afternoon, confession will fill their lips. They will be able to restore their relationship with you the way David did, the way Moses did, the way Elijah did, and others. And I pray, Lord of Lords, that you'll forgive their sin, because that's what you promise in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Amen.